Toastmasters, ladies and gentlemen, fellow members, and most welcome guests. As it was said in the speech objective, there has been some pre-communication before this speech. So if anyone hasn't had the chance to read the documentation, I've got some handouts as well. So please take one if you haven't had the chance to do that. So this speech is going to be an attempt to answer a very complex question. What went wrong with the British economy since 1945? Let's all wind back in time a second first. 1945. Hooray! The war has been won. Factories from these are the Spitfire and the Hurricane on the Battle of Britain. Tanks, guns, and ammunition that equipped an army that went on to liberate Europe and win the war in Asia. Meanwhile, in Germany, it's year zero. The country is in ruin. The people are destitute. 12 million of them are fleeing from Poland, Czechoslovakia, and Yugoslavia, with just the clothes on their backs, and they've been expelled from their homes. The country has got no hope to recover. As the Observer of the Day are saying, no hope whatsoever. It is a broken down hell hole. 15 years later, 1960, the German economy is just about to surpass the British economy as Europe's largest and most powerful economy, to get the crown of Europe's most powerful nation. What happened? What went wrong? How can a country go in 15 years from being the victor of a major world war to in effect being behind economically, when infrastructure, cities and people were intact and far from destitute? Nowadays, Germans are about 10% richer than Britons on average. Americans, the other victors of World War II, are about 25 to 30% richer than us. Just imagine for a second what all of us could do if we had 10%, 20%, or even 30% more money in our pocket. If this country had 10 to 30% more money in its pocket. Imagine what could be done. And the power that would derive from that, economical, cultural, and also political. What the hell went wrong with this country? Books have been written on the subject, university courses have been done on it, and world TV programs as well. And the answer can be boiled down to three very simple things. People, the plant, infrastructure, and last but not least, politics. So let's start off with the first one, people. Even before the war, a need was identified with this country to bring up education standards to the level of Germany, if not above, especially regarding the technical education, technician, tradespeople, to meet the needs of a growing and modern economy. And an ambitious plan was launched just before the end of the war, the 1944 Education Act. And under this plan, a tripartite education system would be grammar school for intellectuals, technical school to train scientists, technicians and engineers, and secondary modern school for managers and employees. On paper, this system was a world beater. On paper. The reality, however, was slightly different. It was meant to be about a third each, with a parity of esteem between each part. But technical schools only ever got about 5% of pupils. There was no parity of esteem whatsoever. About 20 years later, this entire system was scrapped and destroyed, put into the dustbin of history. And the present system we've got today has been put in place. That is once again up for reform. And the perennial, the full filigram in the debate of let's turn every single school into an academy says one thing, that we see 70 years on, failed to provide a decent education to our children. These are the latest piece of test scores. Germany is way above us. Singapore, the word beater, is above us. Shanghai is not on this table, but they are way above Singapore. We do not have a world-class education system in this country. As simple as that. But there's a lot more to that as well. In addition to being ill-educated, the British workforce was at war with itself. Us, the managers, the toughs, the aristocrats. Them, the workers, the guy on the production line. At war with itself, torn apart into never-ending class war. And the result was that during 1950s to the 1980s, there were 10 times more strikes in this country compared to Germany or maybe other major European competitors. Rubbish piling up in the street in 1979 was the result. A country at war with itself. So the software was really buggy and not working well. What about hardware then? Well, again, just before and after the war, they said, the infrastructure of this country is not fit for purpose. We need to modernize it and build something that is world class. This was the theory. 70 years on, what is the result? Do we have a world class transport system? No, yep. We don't. Germany has got an average 3 times more motorway than the EU. This is per capita. Obviously, it's a big country, but this is a per capita figure. 3 times more motorway. More high-speed line, we only have one. An electrified rail network, and they don't have the national disgrace that is called Heathrow Airport. Now, you might be saying, well, surely, what plans were they? And how does it matter to us? Who here has ever been stuck outside the toy tube station as it was closed to prevent overcrowding? Very few of you. Well, Victoria Station here has 2 tube lines. In 1948, some clever planners said Victoria needs 5 tube lines at least to work properly. Only one of them ended up being built in the end. This is the date, today's result of poor decision made almost 70 years in the past. Now, obviously, tube lines, motorways, it's all expensive. Where is the money going to come from? Well, we simply didn't invest enough. The data could only go back to 1970, but there is only 1 year where we invested more than Germany in our infrastructure, in plant, in machinery, in equipment. We're still not investing as much as they do. And investment is money that is set aside for your return on the future. We are, in effect, facing the future. We're not preparing and equipping ourselves for the future. But it's expensive. Where is the money going to come from? Well, this country had a massive opportunity, like Germany, something that people, other nations always have gone to war for. The North Sea oil. And gas. A bonanza when it was found in the 1960s. A new Saudi Arabia that could re-equip British manufacturing, British industry and British country. What happened since? Well, Norway, the Norwegian Vikings were very clever. They said all that money, we're going to stash it away into a fund to invest it into pension, schools and so on. In this country, it was just flushed on the drain into tax reductions, a few other things, consumption, consumed and burnt away. How much money are we talking about? At the very least, £400 billion. This is the cost, the accumulated cost, of 30 nuclear power stations, which could put the electricity sector of this country carbon-free overnight. 5 crossrails, not 1, 5 crossrails. Hundreds of schools, hospitals, bring our workforce to the next level. And 2 new runways in Eastwood. Flushed down the drain. Now, at the end of the day, it's all down to politics, isn't it? Because politicians are the ones that make the decision on where the money of this country should be spent. And let's see in British politics, Europe or the Commonwealth, the city or manufacturing, key decisions that have never ever been made and never been decided from one side or the other. After the war, we wanted to be at the junction of Europe or the Commonwealth, a leader in both. We got neither. Nor the leadership of the Commonwealth, nor the leadership of Europe, because no such choice was ever made. And what's more, World War II proved one thing to this country. It is that we couldn't afford to defend the British Empire. It was too big, and it just costed a lot of money to have ships, airplanes, and army brigades all over the place. So what did we do after World War II then? Did we just get independence to some places where we should never have set foot upon? Well, we didn't. These are all forgotten conflicts. Emergency, we called them at the time. In plain English, these were colonial wars. Forgotten in this day and age, not even mentioned at school or in history books. Most of you may have only heard about some of these today. Hundreds of young men died in this war. Some of them were 18. National servicemen, conscripts, and millions and billions of pounds were wasted into these places where we should have lowered the flag down and never, ever been back again. The modern version of this could be called Libya, Iraq, or Afghanistan. It's the same problem. And the German and Japanese learned one thing after World War II, is that war never ends. It is best to invest your money at home than to waste and blow it away abroad. Now, what can be done? 70 years on, we haven't done so badly. We're only 10% poorer than Germany. We've got the city of London. And with Florian, there was Maggie Thatcher in the 1980s. She put the countries back into work. The reality is quite complicated. Some of the Thatcherite reform were very much needed, especially in regards to the trade union and labour relations. But ultimately, problems of British productivity, investment and economic decline have never been solved adequately. 70 years of poor decisions coming home to roost today. What does it matter, I would like to say? But I mean, at the end of the day, you sound like you're saying a lot of bad things will happen. Well, this country is very rich, but actually a lot of money is going away. War here is familiar with the concept of the balance of payments. What a few people. Imagine you're a country is an household. And if an household loses money every year, this is your balance of payment. How big is it for the UK? How much money are we gaining or losing every year? £98 billion. £15,000 a year for every man, woman and child in this country. This is a hell of a lot of money. Now what can be done? Are we all doomed? No, we're not. We have the power. We have the choice to avert financial benefit and eventually the chicken will be coming home to roost. Prosperity is a choice. The German economic miracle was not a miracle, it was a choice that German politicians did in the 1940s that set the course of their country 70 years hence to be prosperous. What can we do today? Well, there is a huge number of opportunities that we can still harness. Number one, you guys. People of this country, native, adopted, all of us. Some of, just think about these people in the northern cities, in Scotland, Teesside, northern side, underemployed, bereft of hope, there's nothing to do. This is an army of producers in waiting, a workforce of millions of people that is just waiting the command to be trained. The decision to lower the minimum wage, to be turned into a vast army of producers that will get the country back to work once again. But there is another bigger opportunity that lies just under our feet. The North Sea, our legacy, was whittled away and blown away. But we have a second chance. Share oil and share gas. This is not hundreds of billions we're talking about here, but trillions of pounds that are just waiting to be fracked out of the ground and sold to wherever we want them overseas. Prosperity is a choice. Prosperity is only a choice.